Hey everybody, how are we doing tonight? Everyone good? Awesome. Well, as she said, my name is Eli Nesbitt. I'm from the Lexus College, and I'm extremely excited to be here presenting RZ to you all. It's something that we've been working towards for a long time, and we're very excited with what we have to bring to you today and tomorrow. So it'll be an action-packed day. I do want to kind of start off, I know questions are going to come up. We want to answer all of those questions. We are going to have a question and answer time at the end of this. So if you have any, just please write them down. We'll get to all of them. And I guarantee if I don't know the answer, I'll find somebody who does and get back to you. So please make sure that you have all your questions. That's kind of my thing. If I don't know what I'm going to get for you. So with that being said, let's kick this right off and get right into it. So it's going to be a little bit of a high-level kind of intro to the RZ for you today. We'll get more in-depth with it sitting next to the actual car tomorrow morning before your drives. But we're going to go over a little bit about design, a little bit about that driving performance, as well as technology and driver assistance and safety. So starting with our design, we have here seamless e-motion. So that was going to be kind of that core design theme or inspiration for this vehicle. As you can see here, the stages of concepting started very coupe-like there on the left-hand side. We wanted to keep that nature of fun to drive, kind of performance-oriented design, but we wanted the practicality of a small SUV, as that's kind of the growing or most popular segment. So as you see here today, it did kind of transfer from a coupe-like design and then kind of grow a little bit in size to be this small SUV. We do want to touch on a little bit about that spindle body. I know that Caitlin mentioned it, and you'll see it especially in the bi-tone execution. So with that, those kind of darker areas you see here would be flipped, so those highlights are kind of lowlights and vice versa. So that's a definite kind of newer taste of Lexus, and we're very proud of that. And kind of dating back to LC at Motomachi, we had this theme of concept car coming to life. And we want our concept images to be very close to what comes to production. And as you see here, keep in mind those two images on the right especially. This is the production unit here, so very, very close to that concept image coming to life, and that really is a defining factor for our design moving forward. So that darker portion underneath the headlight there is going to be what flips when you get a bi-tone, and then the entire spindle body shape is going to flow all the way over the top of the vehicle to the back of the trunk, and that'll be an onyx color. So not caviar, it'll be a true dark black, so it'll be a very striking design. And Caitlin mentioned we have multiple of those tomorrow for you to drive. I do want to note that wheel is also the wheel that she mentioned. That's an optional 20 on 18 or on premium. So that's going to be a black with machine finish wheel. And then that's the standard wheel for luxury. And then the gray wheel you already saw would be that luxury option only. So those lines flow all the way from the back of that spindle body design and kind of end in those vortex generators over the rear glass. You also see a lot of sculpted intentional design along the side of the vehicle. So we wanted it to look very striking from every angle, and you can kind of see it appears to be very wide and low to the ground in the rear. That's to kind of speak to the exciting acceleration that is kind of just inside of all EVs. That initial torque is very fun, and it's kind of a new next generation of Lexus design. So you'll see kind of these more sculpted lines soon. Also there's that full width blade taillight, the Lexus logo spelled out in the back. Kind of an interesting thing to have the new NX and RX just come out, and we're bringing out another small or mid-size four-door SUV. So in your mind's eyes, I'm sure most of you have already driven the NX and RX the past 2 years. This is where the RZ sits between those two models. So overlaid on the RX here is going to be the NX in that purple or violet color. So you'll see it's about 7 inches shorter than the RZ. But looking back or thinking back of that, the RX you probably all drove recently, that's gonna be that light blue line. So you're gonna see it's actually the exact same wheelbase as RZ. So even though the RZ appears from the outside to be a smaller vehicle, it's actually the same length as an RX, and you really feel it on the interior. This vehicle's going to have more headroom and legroom than both the NX and RX, even though it's shorter to the ground, and you can see that the roof line is shorter. So even though it appears to be more coupe-like, it's gonna be a more expansive, open interior on the for the driver and the passengers. As well, I'd like you to note that that really low hood line. So that hood line is serving two purposes. It's going to be obviously better for coefficient of drag, which is 0.29, it's the lowest in our lineup today. But it also provides an expansive visibility for all the drivers. So with that hood slanting down so abruptly, you get a massive view out the front of the windshield. It's very easy to drive this vehicle, no matter what height you are, what driving position you're in. So it leads to that effortless driving that we're going after. A little bit about interior design. So with the EV space, interiors are changing. What's offered in those interiors is evolving. It's oftentimes a lot more simple. And so we went with an intentional, simple design, but we wanted it to stay elegant and true to our brand. So we truly feel that this is an elevated and more modern interior that we're offering. So Caitlin mentioned that 14-inch display is going to be that in that center stack on both premium and luxury. You don't have to get a higher grade to get the big screen. It's going to become standard for you. As well as a very simplified interior, she mentioned shadow illumination. We're able to simplify things like door panels from an eco-conscious standpoint and be able to still give the same luxury effect with things like lighting. So we're very excited about that. Dynamic sky panoramic glass roof. This is going to be that option on luxury. So with a touch of a button, you can go from opaque to translucent. It is important to note that even though the panoramic glass roof is standard on all grades, they all come with a low E coating. What that's going to do is repel UV rays and essentially heat from the vehicle. So even though sunlight is entering the vehicle, all the UV rays are going to be repelled off. So as you drive tomorrow, kind of float your hand near the glass. Try feeling how your hand's not going to be warmed up. Then try feeling it, on a typical window or the windshield, something that doesn't have that coating. You'll see an immediate difference that you're not absorbing that heat or UV rays into your hand. So even without the roof in this position, you're still blocking all of those UV rays. So definitely a great option for our guests. Radiant heating. So this is a very exciting Lexus first, and it's going to provide a layer of omotenashi, which is just anticipating those guests' needs and providing them comfort. So in the dash on both the passenger side where the glove box is traditionally, as well as on the driver side, in the steering column is going to be a heating element that's going to work in tandem with the seat heaters. So the idea with that is it's going to provide a sense of warmth, similar to wearing a blanket around your legs or just heating up the lower extremities, getting that blood back to the heart. The driver and passenger will feel much more comfortable and much warmer very, very quickly. And that is a very elegant thing to feel. If it's cold enough tomorrow, some of the weather looks like it's gonna be a little cold this time. I hope you get to enjoy this. In Texas, it's kind of iffy when we get to experience this because it can be so hot, but when it's cold, it's definitely nice to have. So it's gonna be a great kind of thing to experience. One thing to note with radiant heater is you do not have a glove box in this vehicle in the traditional spot, but I always like to say you didn't lose it, we moved it. So instead of having to reach all the way over to the passenger side, a similar amount of average space that's usually found in the glove box is actually going to be found underneath the center console. So the driver can easily put their hand underneath the center console and grab whatever they would normally stow in a glove box. So even though the glove box has moved, you haven't lost that space. So always kind of a benefit there. Here's a kind of an up-close image of that shadowy illumination that's going to be standard. So as you open and close the doors, that image is going to change because of where it is shown onto the door panel. It's really beautiful at nighttime and in low light situations. You're driving in the middle of the day, it might be very faint or hard to see at all. But if you go into a parking structure or you're able to kind of cup your hands, you'll be able to see it. And in any low light situation, it's very, very elegant. You can also turn it off and on or up and down in brightness all through the screen. Dial type shifter. This is a Lexus first. We're very excited about this. We had the kind of next generation of shift-by-wire on RX and NX that debuted on LC and LS, and this is a new style of shift-by-wire, so it's a dial type shifter. One thing I'd love for all of you to note when you drive tomorrow is that a lot of intention was placed in how the material is made and what it feels like under your fingertips, as well as the angle of that dial. So as you rotate the dial to the right for drive or to the left for reverse, you'll notice that you don't have to move your actual wrist. Because it has an angle upwards, you can just simply move it without moving your wrist at all. So it's one of those things that shows a little bit of intention in the design, where it could have very easily been a straight cylinder wall and you would have had to kind of rotate your whole arm, but because of that slight angle, you're able to have a benefit of just being able to use it with just a fingertip. Steer by wire, I know we're gonna have plenty of questions and we're ready to and excited to talk about it. With the steer by wire system, you're not only just getting a different steering wheel, it's every nut and bolt different from a hardware standpoint, including the dashboard. So one of the benefits of having the top of your steering wheel disappear is we can actually elevate the driver's line of sight. So when you have a steer-by-wire equipped vehicle, that dashboard is actually going to be further away from you and raised up, so it's more natural in your line of sight. This prevents the need for the driver to crane their neck down, so it reduces neck strain. It also allows them to completely look out the front of the vehicle and get a better look at their MID. So just another one of those touches that makes everything a little bit more intentional as we go through. We'll have a opportunity to drive steer-by-wire in a closed course as well as on the street tomorrow, so you'll definitely get lots of time with it. And during our walk around tomorrow morning, we'll get very in-depth on the specifics of steer-by-wire. A little bit about driving performance. It's kind of the fun and the nitty-gritty. It's always the fun stuff with my background, so I love this section. Here's a little bit of the high-level performance specs. Once again, you'll all receive this in your documentation. So 71.4 kilowatt-hour battery capacity with an EPA estimated range of 220 on 18-inch wheels and 196 with any vehicle equipped with 20s. So premium with the 20-inch wheel or standard and luxury with the 20-inch wheel can have that 196 range estimate. 308 to 313 horsepower. So you might have seen both of those numbers in different press releases. It's the same number, it's the same calculation from the kilowatts. That's gonna be the imperial or the metric horsepower number. So both are correct, it's just whichever system you're using. That is from 230 kilowatts of power from the front and rear e-axles. So we'll get into that in a little bit, as well as that ETNGA platform. So that's a first for Lexus. Caitlin mentioned that. That's our first dedicated BEV platform that we've had at the brand, as well as a direct four all-wheel drive. So if you came to any of the RX events, direct four was introduced first on RX, but it is brought to a new light here today, with not only one e-axle, but two e-axles, so we're very excited about that. A little bit about Lexus driving signature. So with the evolution of vehicles towards this fully electrified state, we are able to really evolve the Lexus driving signature. And so we're seeing for the first time the true next chapter of what Lexus driving signature means for our electrified platforms. Lots of things go into that. That's not really a one-off thing. It's all the systems working together and having a cohesive nature and a cohesive conversation. It's going to be a more linear experience for the driver. So everything is about intention and how things work together. So with that being said, when we look at all those specs on paper, we want to make sure that the whole vehicle is not lost, right? Ingredients make up great dishes, but it's up to the chef on how to prepare them. So if you give the same ingredients or the same specs to many things, it's not going to feel the same. The way that you put them together is going to be very important. So we want to highlight the entire drive experience, the entire guest experience with RZ. It's not solely one thing on a piece of paper, but an entire experience, an entire drive, driving unit. So I hope you all enjoy that drive tomorrow. We also wanted to speak to the chief engineer's inspiration of it being a natural vehicle. So he wanted this vehicle to be very natural for first-time BEV adopters, as well as people who are used to the Lexus brand and our products. That means that throughout the entire build of this vehicle, choices were made to stay true to that goal and that inspiration. He wanted everything to feel as natural as possible with a very minimal learning curve. As you'll all experience tomorrow, it is very simple to get in this vehicle and understand how to operate it. Especially if you've been to any of our most recent launches, it's almost no learning curve at all. So it's a very natural vehicle getting into the vehicle, and even the way that it drives, the way that it handles. It's going to be very confidence-inspiring, it's going to be very fun to drive, and it's not going to catch you by surprise other than how fun it is. With that ETNGA platform, which is a Lexus first, we are going to have a very optimized BEV platform. So you see there that full-size battery, essentially wheel-to-wheel, is going to be placed very low to the ground, which gives us a fantastic center of gravity, as well as our e-axles are positioned differently. So we'll speak a little bit more about e-axles soon, but you see the front e-axle is stacked vertically. That's going to be where the motor and transaxle assembly, as well as the PCU and inverter, are stacked in a vertical stack. What that allows us to do is have an exceptional crash zone in the front for safety and optimize the legroom for the front passengers. Those same components are repackaged in the rear in a horizontal platform. So what that's going to do is give us a really flat loading deck, lower than NX, lower than RX, and a very usable trunk space. So not only are we designing it to fit properly, but we're trying to tie in lots of customer benefits with that. Direct four all-wheel drive is one of those things that's really going to be bringing the Lexus driving signature to life with this vehicle. So with the ability of having motor, transaxle, PCUs, or power control units, and inverters, both in the front and the rear, we can independently power these two powertrains in a kind of a symbiotic conversation. So we can drive the front and the rear completely separately, all by situation. So it's not just an all-wheel drive system, it's really the philosophy of how we power these units, and it's going to be proprietary just to us. So other vehicles that may use e-axles will never feel the same way because their programming or how they come onto power is completely different, and that's going to be a pure Lexus experience. A little bit about those e-axles here, you see that PCU and inverter are stacked on top. That is, you know, kind of us building on 30 years plus of building EV components. So those inverters are something we've been building since the 90s and is kind of the sixth generation of that technology here today, as well as the motor and transaxle assembly down below. So kind of complete units, a different take of just having dual motor or multiple motors where it's just simply motors in the front and rear and centralized inverters and power control units. Everything's kind of has its own powertrain set up front and rear. 150 kilowatt output in the front and 80 kilowatt in the rear, which is going to lead to that 230 kilowatt output, which is right over 300 horsepower, 308 to 313, depending on which calculator you use. A little bit about battery specs. We have a lithium ion battery. It's going to be 96 cells and 71.4 kilowatt hours. It's going to be not only water cooled, but also have refrigerant lines. So it's going to be refrigerant and water cooled through the case. So that case is going to be bolted to the rear of the, or underneath of the body, providing a significant increase in body rigidity, which leads to a very fun car to drive, just even by having that weight and rigidity on the bottom of the chassis, as well as exceptional cooling capabilities. Some of that battery cooling is kind of laid out here, so you're gonna see little channels kind of built into the actual steel case outside the battery. So intentional design is going to be not only an improvement for performance, but also longevity of that battery. So with our battery management software, and the cooling mechanisms built all in, we're very confident about the life of our batteries. And I always say we've been building batteries longer than, you know, high voltage batteries longer than anyone else on the road. And if there's any concerns about how we make our batteries go to New York and get a cab, it's always gonna be a hybrid system that we're related to picking you up. So whether that be a Camry or a RAV4 hybrid, it's always gonna be something like that picking you up. So we're very confident in the longevity of our battery technology and how we keep them cool. Drive mode select. We've all kind of seen things like this. There is one new mode that we want to highlight here, and that is going to be that range mode. So you're going to see quite a few things change when you turn on range mode. Most significantly is going to be your HVAC turns off. So when in range mode, initially your air conditioning turns off. You can, with the touch of a button, turn it back on to your previous setting, but if you're playing around with it tomorrow and you tap range mode, just know that your AC will turn off until you decide to turn that back on. In range mode, it's also going to be extremely rear-wheel drive bias. So because we have full control of the e-axles independently, all-wheel drive is not changing a power split. It's just simply not utilizing the front axle. But if there was a situation from safety or a slipping situation were to occur, even in range mode, that front e-axle is completely active and ready to go. So in a situation where it needs to be there, you will have all-wheel drive functionality even in range mode. But the, you know, significant changes, you'll be using that 80 kilowatt rear e-axle for the predominant amount you're driving in range mode. A little bit about body rigidity. When you have a vehicle that has all of its power come on immediately, like a BEV, a lot of thought has to be going into the design of the body structure. And you'll see here that double annular structure in the rear. That definitely provides a very rigid base for the, you know, vehicle to resist twisting motions and high acceleration. Other e-axle vehicles or ETNGA platform vehicles are a little bit different in their body structure. We have some additional points that are proprietary just to the RZ. And one of those things would be some of the bracing on the A-pillar is gonna be much more rigid. It has an additional brace as well as thicker steel material for a more rigid ride. That provides for a very thrilling and kind of exciting drive experience with all of the body stiffening. It can be very flat and low to the ground and be a very fun vehicle to drive. A little bit about the technology. It's going to have LSS Plus 3.0. That is going to be the same exact LSS package that came with the RX, so no additional content there. It's going to have that 14-inch screen standard with interface, so that's going to do wireless, Apple CarPlay, and Android Auto, all of those good things. And it's always nice to not have to option into the big screen, you already get it. With LSS Plus 3.0, you do get some additional features standard with luxury, like traffic jam assist. So if you have experienced that already, it is the same on this vehicle. It'll be a little difficult to experience on your drive tomorrow because you do have to be on a actual highway. So unless you have a long enough time there and are in traffic, it'll be a little difficult, but I'm happy to speak to it or walk you through how you would experience that in a different drive setting. Along with traffic jam assist, there is a driver monitor camera. So those two functions of driver monitor cameras paired with traffic jam assist equipped vehicles. The reason we bring this up now is if you're planning to film in your vehicle tomorrow, we can go ahead and isolate some of the alerts and still keep the driver monitor camera active. So you won't have any alerts for driver inattention if you're looking around and experiencing the vehicle, but the camera will still operate from a safety standpoint and a function standpoint. We can also turn it off completely. We can turn the camera off You would also lose the function of TJA if you were to be in a traffic jam on a highway. So just to kind of level set on that. And if you have any further questions about driver monitor camera, we can handle those at that time.